Hi. By now you will have commenced your study of research methods in business and organizations, and you will be currently grappling with the whole concept of paradigms and thinking about why they're such an important part of what we're dealing with when we talk about research, and particularly research into human systems, because that's why the whole concept of paradigms emerges. And hopefully what you're beginning to see is that while we talk about two sort of polar paradigms that almost look like competing paradigms, and in many cases people do see them as competing, in actual fact, as we progress through the unit, hopefully you'll begin to see that there may actually be synergies that can be obtained from utilizing the best of both paradigms, or even adopting some positions in between, because there's more going on than just the positivistic and the interpretive paradigm. There are other paradigms that have evolved to meet certain purposes. But for your initial learning, we focus on the positivistic and the interpretive paradigm, and I just wanted to make a few points about those issues that you're currently grappling with. The whole concept of the paradigm comes about simply because researchers are human beings as well, and they need some kind of guidance as to what the rules of the game are. And those rules evolve over time. They evolve as people think about how to address things, as they think about what constitutes knowledge of the world. And the far older paradigm in terms of studying things in the world and gathering knowledge is the positivistic paradigm. It has roots that go all the way back to Aristotle. And it basically, when applied to human sciences, is taking the methods of natural sciences and just saying, let's just use those to study human behavior as well. And so it's basically the scientific method applied to the study of human behavior and human systems. And it has the expectations that the world is a deterministic thing, that there is an external reality that we can seek to understand, and that as our understanding and evaluations and empirical data grow and our theories get stronger and stronger, eventually we will come to lawful descriptions of why things happen the way they do. In other words, we tend to live in a lawful universe, and one of our goals is to try and tease out cause and effect in that universe. And in the positivistic paradigm, we see that the researcher's perspective is the dominant perspective. It's the driving force, because it's the researcher who theorizes. It's the researcher who then deduces hypotheses, and from those deductions sets up tests of those hypotheses. And then from the outcomes of those tests, and those tests involve gathering empirical data, usually, not always, usually quantitative data, because a part and parcel of this is a strong desire to measure and quantify things that we're talking about. But once the data are in, the hypotheses are evaluated, and then there's an inductive leap back to evaluating the quality of the theory. So it's a circular loop. And we know that there are certain quality criteria associated with what counts as good research done within the context of the positivistic paradigm. And that's where we see the emergence of the validity criteria. Construct validity, internal validity, external validity, statistical conclusion validity. And you can see those detailed a bit more in the slides that have been uploaded for week two on Blackboard. Now, the interpretive paradigm sort of grew up as a reaction against the positivistic paradigm. And it grew from the notion that really the way to understand human systems is to understand how humans make sense of the world that they inhabit. So it led to a paradigm that says what we're really interested in is not the researcher's view of the world, but the researcher trying to gain access to the views of the world that are held by the people and the organizations that are of interest in the investigation. So the participant's perspective becomes the dominant driver. And in that light, we have a situation where the methods of the natural sciences will no longer work. We have to do things differently. The participant voices become key. The researcher tries to learn how people interpret and make sense of the world in light of that understanding. And that means that entirely different quality criteria emerge. No longer do we talk about validity, we talk about things like transparency and authenticity and sufficiency and so on. So all of those things play a role as well. Now, what we can see in the evolution of these different things is that they have different views of what counts as a theory. They have different views about preference for data. Positivistic, strong preference for quantitative data. Interpretive paradigm, strong preference for qualitative data, and so on. So it raises the additional question that if the research inside each of those paradigms can be held to account in terms of quality against standards, quality criteria within the paradigm, what happens if we want to say, how would we know any bit of research is good, irrespective of what paradigm it's done? Well, in that sense, you need some kind of meta-criteria, some overarching or helicopter view criteria to help you make those judgments. And that's where the meta-criteria come into play. The meta-criteria talk about high-quality research as being research where there is clear contextualization of the research in a larger scheme of things, relative to the past literature and what others have done, relative to the specifics of the situation being evaluated, relative to the researcher's own position and role, and relative to the position and role of all the participants and other sources of data, like documents, emails, speeches, films, whatever else might be there. And then there we have criteria that target the realization, the execution of the research, how well it's been done. And there we talk about how internally coherent the research has been. Does it have analytical integrity? And what kind of extensional reasoning does the researcher want to put into play? And it's with those specific meta-criteria that it does become important to think back to the guiding assumptions and paradigm that's driving the research, because that's where their quality criteria can actually enter the frame. So internal coherence for a positivistic study is what internal validity is all about. Internal coherence from an interpretive point of view is what things like transparency and authenticity are on about. Okay, so we can see the different meta-criteria can be viewed differently depending on the paradigm. And then we have the explication meta-criteria, which all refer to the telling of the story. And in fact, these are critical in terms of how the researcher has handled unexpected outcomes and surprises, how they have displayed the messages, the take-home messages, the value for learning, how well they have indicated what their research might mean for further research, the fertilization of ideas, whether or not they've come clean and acknowledged the limitations of their own research process, had they been critical in terms of the limitations of their method, because that can actually add value to for learning. And finally, the presentational character. Has the overall presentation of the research hit the mark? Is it appropriate for the target? And the meta-criteria are all meant to inform a central judgment, which is, at the bottom line, what constitutes high-quality research is whether or not it convinces somebody about the conclusions that it wants to draw. In other words, does the research have convincingness? And what we note is that these meta-criteria can cross-inform each other so that doing well on one can help amplify the story against another and so on. So that's really a very brief sketch of why the issue of paradigms and meta-criteria is so critical for our study of organizational research methods. And hopefully, as you begin to dig around in this, as you begin to work toward the first assignment, you'll begin to see this, and it will have more meaning for you as you continue your journey. Thanks a lot.